Auraria historically was the German community in Denver, and there was a battle in the beginning sort of between Denver and Auraria about which was going to be the capital and the metropolis. But Auraria in Latin essentially means gold, and people came here in the 1850s for the gold rush, and with them they brought a lot of traditions, and one of those was breweries and brewing. The first brewer that started what would become the Tivoli, his name was Moritz Ziggy, and if you go in the Tivoli today, there's Ziggy's Pool Hall and Ziggy's Cabaret, which is a conference room. In 1875, Ziggy was killed in a freak accident on the streets of Denver. He was in a horse-drawn carriage and his horses were spooked by dogs, and the carriage flipped over and he died. And that sort of started the evolution of what some people call the Tivoli curse.
A lot of the employees, late night employees, hear the sound of a little girl.
One of the night crew ladies, she was cleaning and she looked down the hallway and she saw a little girl playing in a dress, and she thought that the little girl was one of the like maybe a professor's child that was just kind of messing around after hours. And so when she went to go find the little girl to get the little girl back to her parents, she said she saw the little girl run into the corner. And when she went over there, she couldn't find the little girl anymore. She kind of heard laughing and playing, but the little girl wasn't on the third floor.
Legend has it is that she lived in a house that was built where the 84 wing is now, but she apparently died in her bedroom.
There's a thought out there, a theory, that some people, when they pass, if they do come back as, you know, some type of spirit, they will regress to their happiest moments. And that, I mean, as a little girl, I can see that that would be, you know, maybe a happy moment for her.
There's a death story that doesn't necessarily correlate with a ghost haunting, but the copper kettles that are in the building currently, those used to have to be cleaned by hand. So people would get inside of the kettles and would scrub them with mops and brushes. Apparently over a weekend, a guy was inside the kettle cleaning it, and he slipped and fell and impaled himself with his broom or whatever it was. And he laid dead and dying in the kettle for 2 days until the next Monday when the cleaning crew came in and the cleaning woman came by and found him dead in the kettle. A lot of folks will tell you, like the Cryptoscience Club and groups like that, that the most haunted or paranormally active part of the building is the catacombs area and the Ziggy's Cabaret area. These are at the base of the tower.
A few light switches in this room. This is the section that apparently raises the most paranormal flags, is this boxed-in section here. Some people speculate that it was an old, not a dumbwaiter, but a really tiny elevator shaft that might have gone up into the tower for the business office and all that.
So in Ziggy's Cabaret, there's a section right next to it that the public isn't ordinarily allowed in. We got special permission to go in there. We just set up motion sensing cameras, a regular video camera, some audio recording devices, and pretty much locked it up. Just left it alone, made sure nobody went in or out. The video camera experienced what we call battery drain. A lot of times what'll happen in places with a lot of activity, a fully charged battery will inexplicably completely drain out and then return to full power a couple minutes later. This happened to the video camera. We shut the video camera off. Simultaneously, during that time frame, while the camera was off, the audio recorder picked up a number of sounds, including metal banging, sounds of music, and what sounds like a little girl sighing.
Inside the catacombs itself, which is where the beer cooling pipes are still, there's two sections of wall that don't show up on the plans of the building.
We've taken out just a few of the bricks, and you can see sort of there's some openings and things in there. But eventually what we'd like to do is actually break these open and see what's behind them.
I think it's just going to be in a bunch of old beer bottles, but it would still be interesting to do all the same.
Mm-hmm.
just did a revitalization, a $28 million revitalization on the building that students approved in 2001. And there was a crew of heating and air conditioning contractors that actually refused to work alone in the building. They went to their foreman and said, "We have heard too many ghosts, we hear the little girl, we won't work alone, we have to be in pairs."
The story reports of a Tivoli worker here who was working the night shift and was standing at this window looking out one night all by himself, and he felt a hand on his shoulder that turned him around quickly like this, and there was nobody there who could have touched him or turned him around like that.
So these people would not go into parts of the building without being paired up. And these are, you know, big burly construction guys, and you know, they hadn't wanted nothing to do with working alone in the building.
I would say no student should be afraid of, you know, anything that happens in the Tivoli.
From everything I've heard, none of the ghosts are mean ghosts. They don't try to scare people or you know, scare them away or things like that. A lot of them are welcoming. When you look around the rest of the campus, there aren't a lot of historic, unique buildings. Hopefully students don't take for granted what they have. It's an amazing facility. It has, you know, students should spend some time wandering through the building and going to places. You know, it's got more than a McDonald's and a bookstore. There is a lot of things in the building that are wonderful.